Praise God. Praise God. Oh, shit, I shit. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Good God Almighty. Wow. It's been a great morning. It's been a very blessed morning. I'm looking forward to the rest of the day. I pray that you are as well. I pray that your morning has been as blessed and as fruitful and as prosperous as mine has been. It is it's an honor. It truly is. I consider it an honor to be able to come before you on Sunday morning and any other time that the Lord leads. And something I've felt off and on at times and have gotten confirmation yet this morning is that we need to be live considerably more often than what we are. We need to, yes, we have our scheduled times as a ministry that God has given us. Most of you that follow us would know that we were here on Sunday mornings at 11, and of course Tuesdays with Rock Through the Scriptures at 7 p.m. And Tamara is also live on Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. with the Word from the Lord. And something that, quite frankly, she was talking about this morning has impressed upon me that we do need to be shall we say, feeding the sheep even more often than we do. 3 times a week will certainly help people grow if in fact you do that. But 4 or 5 times a week would be, and it doesn't have to be a long time. You know, and this is something that I'm sure Tamara's would agree with me. It's like, in the future, when the Lord impresses something upon us, we're not going to necessarily say, well, that was a message for Thursday, or, well, that'll be a message for Sunday. No, sometimes the Lord is giving us a right now message. And I feel like we, and I'm sure Tamara will agree, I'm sure you'll see a comment from her here in a moment, that when God gives us a right now message, guess when we need to give it? Yeah, you got that right. Right now. And if that's, you know, a Wednesday evening or a Friday evening or a Saturday morning, then that's what we need to be doing. You know, sometimes, you know, not all of us will see tomorrow. God may give us a word for someone that will lead them to salvation, and tomorrow would have been too late. And so I make a commitment to you, and I know that I will get agreement from Tamara. She is watching right now, that we, as a ministry, make a commitment to you that when the Lord gives us a right now word, we will, in turn, come on here, wherever it is. You know, last Sunday, I went off to myself under the trees in a park. And so it doesn't matter where we are. If I hadn't happened to be sitting on a fishing bank and the Lord gives me a word, then I'm going to, I'll tie the poles down, whatever it takes, and give the word. And so I make that commitment to you now, that when the Lord gives us a right now word, and it's funny because in a way, in my mind, that what I'm saying now ties into the word God gave me today. In a sense that we need to use what God has given us. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father God, for this time. We pray, Father God, all of you, none of me. I pray, Lord God, you open hearts, minds, and ears to hear, receive, understand what it is you're saying this morning, Father. as we claim every single promise in your word, Lord God, as personal. We take your promises, that promise of prosperity, that promise of health, that promise of using us, Father, that promise of being a blessing, that promise of being blessed, Father God, and the hundreds of other promises in your word, Father, we claim every one of them for me. And when I say me, you should be saying me. Claim the word of God as true in your life. Hallelujah. Praise God. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right. God bless. I wanted to talk and maybe take a little bit of a different angle and explanation on the gifts of the Spirit this morning. I will say this right up front. You were born with a gift and or gifts. Many people, including myself and including my wife, Tamara, walk in multiple gifts of the Spirit. I've seen people walk in virtually, there were one single person walk in virtually every gift of the Spirit. And frankly, I have operated in pretty much every gift of the Spirit at any given time. But my point being here is you were born with it. You didn't have a choice. When that doctor went slam and you took that breath and started whining and crying, the gifts of God were already in you. He already planted them in you. He had it planned from the beginning of time. So those gifts, it doesn't matter whether you like it or not. It doesn't, that's not relevant to the fact that the gifts of God are in you. Now that doesn't mean your calling. That doesn't necessarily mean apostle, prophet, evangelist, okay, the fivefold ministry type of things. Although the gifts operate and tie into that fivefold ministry. You know, you weren't born an apostle. You weren't born a pastor. But you were born with a gift. And like anything, you were born with the ability to speak whatever language you have since learned. You were born with the ability to speak that language. But you had to develop that language. You had to develop using that language. It was a process. Your first word may have been mommy or daddy or Baba or Dada or whatever, but and you moved on from there to where you can speak fluently in the language that you have learned, okay? But you learned it. You learned to use that God-given ability to use your voice. And it's the same with the gift. You were born, I'm telling you, you can deny this if you want. But I can tell you one thing. You're wrong. You were born with a gift. Now, let's look at those for a moment. And I'm going to read down just a short list of the gifts. You could add others, okay? In the Bible, throughout the Bible, it mentions different gifts. But these are the ones that are commonly referred to and known as the gifts of the Spirit, okay? A word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, a gift of prophecy. Now, I'll stop here for a moment. I have been used to give a prophetic word to someone. I don't operate in the office of a prophet under the fivefold ministry as of yet. And I say that like this. God gave me a gift of prophecy. He called me into the office of an apostle, as we have several other ministries under us right now. And it's an action word. And I am developing the gift of prophecy. All right? I just want to make that clear. There's a gift of faith. It doesn't mean that you have to have this gift to have faith. I have faith. I have incredible faith in God and what He is doing, what He will do, and what He has done. I have, you know, I, like I said, my testimonies would, somebody would be cooking breakfast if I started now with my testimonies and kept going. But there is also a gift of faith. I see that in operation myself. I see it in operation every day. Because my precious wife, who is watching today with all of you, walks in a gift of faith. There have been times in our walk as a ministry, as a couple, and me as a person, where I have had, yes, I had faith, but I needed more. And I had to draw on that gift of faith that was given to her. She was born with that gift of faith. I've not seen anybody with any greater faith. Gift of healings. You know, Benny Hinn is a great example. And, you know, we all were told, especially as leaders, that we should be able to lay our hands on this sickness, should be healed. That's true. I've done it. So, in a sense, I have walked in the gift of faith. The working of miracles is another. Discerning of spirits. We can all pray for discernment, but there is a gift of discerning of spirits. And I'm guessing she may be watching with my wife, but my sister-in-law walks in this. She's told us things about people, and frankly, I'll be honest, I say, but, you know, 6 months down the road, oh, she was right. She knew it through that gift of that discernment of spirits. Yes, we should all have discernment, but there is a special gift of discerning spirits. And we're going somewhere with this morning. So just saying, the different kinds of tongues and the interpretation of tongues. Yes, I walk in all both of those. You know, and I'm not blowing my own horn. I'm simply saying God gave me those gifts before I was born. He had already ordained me to have those gifts, the gifts of tongues and the gifts of interpretation. I've done that. I've done that in large congregations. I've done it sitting at our dining room table. Again, all glory to God. All glory to God. Okay? Because if He hadn't given them to me, I wouldn't be able to use them. And quite frankly, to this today, I have to depend on God to use it. Yeah, God put the gift of interpretation in me, but without someone speaking in tongues and without Him giving me the interpretation, I can't do it. So it's from Him and it's only by Him that I can use it. And that's true with every gift. I don't have to look at them. I don't have to read them. There, I can tell you that every single gift in the Word of God is from Him and can only be used through Him. You can't use the gift of prophecy without God. Now, there are people that were born with that gift. They have signs on their front doors, fortune tellers. Some of them are as fake as a $3 bill. But others are misusing a gift of God. You know, sadly. They have to answer for it, not me. And so, but we have to learn to use those gifts. It is, in fact, a process. Okay? That these gifts, as I said, I know I was born with certain gifts, but I can't use them without developing them. They're like like I was talking about earlier with your speech. You were born with the ability to speak. But it had to be developed. And it's the same with every one of these gifts. If you're not willing to develop them, then you're not going to walk in them. And that's a very sad state. I want to go into the book of 1 Corinthians right now, in chapter 12. And I'm just going to read. I think I had planned to read, the first 19 verses. And I'll go through them quickly, but I can't promise that I won't stop, because, you know, if the Holy Spirit gives me something to say, then I'm going to say it. But anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it says this. Now discerning spiritual gifts, concerning spiritual gifts, forgive me, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Now, he's talking to a specific group, but this applies to us today. If you're not Jewish, you're Gentile. Cut the deck, okay? Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. And let's get right on into the meat. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Stop. Pause. It's the same Spirit. There's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There are other spirits, but they're not of God. There is only one Spirit. In the land of God, in the kingdom of God, there is only one Spirit that is part of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. And so when we say that they are from the Spirit, we know that when God penned this, he was talking about the Holy Spirit. There are different differences of ministries, but the same Lord. Now, I take that, okay? We have a good friend that is probably the boldest. As a matter of fact, we have a couple of good friends. But they have a very bold street ministry. They go out on the corner and preach the gospel. They go out on the corner and wait for people to walk by and preach the gospel to them, or to give them a prophetic word or a word of wisdom, whatever, okay, on the street corner. That's their ministry. That's not mine. Have I done that? Yes. I've given people words from God in many different places. But that is not my main. You won't see me doing that every day. Okay? You're seeing my ministry right now. So there are differences of ministry. Okay? Some people are called to go into prisons and preach the word of God. Some to the street corner. Okay? That's what I was saying. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And that's an absolute fact. We need to understand that. If they are standing on the street corner witnessing to people and whatever he's doing at that particular time, it's still the Lord that's operating in them, the same as the Lord is operating right now, right here in this room with me. Yeah, let's read on. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. The same God. There is only one God. There are lowercase g gods and idols, but there's only one capital G-O-D. Okay. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Now I want you to understand, this is the most important thing that God impressed upon me this morning. This verse 7 right here. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. The gift of prophecy. One for you. If you walk in the gift of prophecy, God didn't give you that gift of prophecy for you. If you walk in the gift of healing, God certainly didn't give you a gift of healing just for you. I mean, are you seriously? You walk in the gift of healing and you're going to sit back and wait till you're sick to use it. Oh, Lord, heal me. Then, you know, okay, yeah, he will. But what about your neighbor? What about that person in Walmart? What about that? You see what I'm saying? The gift is not just for you. Verse 7, it's like, for the profit of all. We were told to use these gifts. Yes, we need to develop them. Yeah, you might get it wrong in your growth. You know, I've spoken something to somebody that I thought came from the Lord, and they're looking at me like, yeah, you're mine, dude. But it was learning. It's a process of learning. You went from da-da to, hey, Dad, can I have the car keys? Didn't happen overnight. But you had to practice. When you were 3 years old, you didn't go up, hey, Dad, can I have the car keys? No. You know, when you were 3 months old, you're 6 months old, you're da-da, da-da, ba-ba. Okay? I tell you a real testimony to me. You know, I went through that phase as a child, da-da, ba-ba, ma-ma. But then, into my later teen years, it's like, hey, Dad, can I have one of your beers? It was, I had to grow. I had to develop my gift of speech. And it's the same with these gifts that God gave us. They have to be developed. They have to be nurtured. Yes, they are developed by gathering yourselves together, not forsaking the gathering ourselves together to edify one another, to provoke each other to love. And part of that is, as ministry, is helping one grow in their gift. You're not going to get right 100% of the time. It's a simple fact. You know, I have been serving the Lord for 23 and a half years. I've been ministering His Word for somewhere, I think, 15 years of that. And I'm telling you, I still mess up sometimes. It is what it is. I don't know anybody that's perfect. I know the greatest TV evangelists you can name. They've had to stand before someone and say, hey, I didn't understand this before when I was preaching about it, but I've came to a new revelation, and this is what... So what I'm saying is, we're all a work in process. We're all continuing to develop. We will be until we hear, well done, good and faithful servant. But let's read on. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. There it is again. Through that same Spirit. There is only one Holy Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of the spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. You can walk, and I'm going to stop here for just a moment. You can walk in multiple of these gifts. I've seen people stand up in church and give a message in tongues, and they themselves immediately interpret it. I've seen where someone else would get up and interpret it. Okay, it just depends. Maybe they both have a gift of interpretations. But we have to be in order, okay? So you can walk in multiple gifts, is my point here, okay? But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills, unity and diversity in one body. For as the body is one and has many members, but all of the members of that one body being many, of one body, so also is Christ. Now, and we need to work together. Tongues, interpretation, they have to work together. Healing and faith, they work together. and all these tie together. And we as the body of Christ have to understand that, and have to understand that we need to use our gifts. Using the body as an example. Say I'm thirsty, which is just so happens at the moment I am. So this will be an actual physical example. I am thirsty. Okay? I have water on the shelf down here on this pulpit. My mouth is telling me I'm thirsty. It's in my brain, you know, it's communicating. The mouth is dry. My mouth is working, but it's dry. And I need a drink. So for me to get that drink, either I got to bend down on my knees and try to grab the lip of that cup with my mouth and try to tip it up, or I can use this part of the body. And I can reach down here and I can pull it up and hold it with my hand. And then to quench my thirst, I must use my mouth. It all worked together. I had to use my feet. They had to move. You know, I had to lean sideways. I had to use the entire body to get that drink. And for us to be effective as a ministry, we need the entire body functioning. Okay. This is funny here. It's hilarious in one way. In another way, it's, you know, you need to take this very seriously. I'm going to skip down here to verse 14. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? I mean, think about it. God gave me a word to deliver this morning. What if I tried to do it with my ear? I couldn't do it. Got to use this mouth. Now I'm hearing as I do that. I'm hearing myself because, trust me, I'm speaking to me as well as you. I don't recall if I've ever came before any setting delivering the Word of God that what it wasn't for me too. Okay, either as a reminder or confirmation or for me to grow. I mean, because I can preach a word that's for me because it's not me preaching. The words coming out of my mouth are being given to me by the Holy Spirit. And so they can very easily be for me because they're not from me. And like I said, I don't recall if I have ever preached a word that wasn't for me as well. But let's read on here. If the whole body were an eye, where would be hearing? Oh, it's right there in Scripture, okay? If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smelling? Good example. You're sitting in your living room and, you know, natural gas has no smell whatsoever. That smell is intentionally put in there. So if there's a leak somewhere, you know it and you can get out and do something about it. Okay? That's a fact. Natural gas that maybe you heat your home with, or maybe your dryer, or maybe your range, whatever. Okay? There is no smell to that. It does not come out of the ground with that smell. It is added for your protection. So the body, the nose, can know there's a problem. We have to have it. And when you smell natural gas and you know it's a problem, you use your feet to escape. Anyway, let's move on here. But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? Okay. We need to understand that we are absolutely one body. We need to understand that the gifts, that we cannot operate at 100% efficiency without the entire body. If someone got up and gave a message in tongues, if the person that was given the gift at birth of interpretation had not been willing to develop that and to walk in it, then the church is out of order. We need the gift of interpretation. If someone comes in sick and you walk in the gift of healing, but you have been given the gift of healing, but you're not willing to do it, the church has failed. That person should have been healed. But because you wouldn't use your gift, you weren't willing to develop it, you weren't willing to serve the Lord that you say you love, that person goes home sick. You know, this stuff is just real. There are some things that hinder us using those gifts. Pride or fear of looking proud. You know, I try to never take any credit or glory myself. God has used me in many different ways and in many of these gifts. And quite frankly, I have been used in literally every one of these gifts at some point or another. Okay, those gifts have came forward. But it wasn't me. I'm just a vessel. I'm just a willing servant of the Lord. That's the only thing I can say about me. Okay. So, but if I took pride, it'll destroy a gift in a heartbeat. Fear will stop you from using it. Overvaluing or devaluing. Remember, every one of these gifts, no matter what you walk in, if it's all of them, you're still only part of the body. We can't overvalue that gift. We need to use it, develop it, but we can't devalue it and say, well, you know what, the pastor should be walking in that. You know what, so-and-so already does that, so they do it better than me. No, they don't. You know why? You know why I can say that with confidence? Because it's the same Spirit. They can't do it better than you. That's saying how the Holy Spirit is playing favoritism. Wow, that is really, you know, trying to compare yourself. We just touched that. Fear of failure. You know, I tend to believe that there are a great number of gifts lying dormant about 5 or 6 blocks from here down over the hill in the graveyard because of fear. Fear of failure. Like I said, have I got it right 100% of the time? No way. And neither will you. But the 90%+ of the time that I will get it right, I do not want to have to give an account for not using what God placed in me at birth. These gifts. And they're quite frankly that. They're not earned. They're not achieved. They are gifts. When you give someone a gift, The biggest reason you give someone a gift, what is it? You love them. I would venture to say 100% of the time when you give someone a gift, it's because you love them and you want to honor them. Now you all know where I'm going with this. God gave you gifts because He loves you. This past April, I gave Tamara a gift for her birthday. And I did that because I love her and because I knew it was something she wanted. You need to want these gifts. Ooh, wow. That was straight up from the Holy Spirit. You need to want these gifts. God will give you the desires of your heart. Pray for these gifts. Tamara wanted this specific gift for some time. Frankly, she picked it out. But it was a gift. And I did it because, number one, I love her. Number two, I want to see her use it. And she has. Okay? Let's go on. I love this one. Unwilling to stretch. Yes, you will have to. God will get you out of your comfort zone. I can promise you, you're going to use any of these gifts that we've talked about today. You will be drawn out of your comfort zone. And you will have to depend on God. And again, you have to develop, you have to mature into these gifts. I see people all the time that they walk in a specific gift, but they're not willing to develop, to mature it. They'll give somebody a word in the hallway when no one else is listening or talking, and they'll do it in such a way to cover themselves in case they're wrong. But they won't develop it to a point of standing in front of a congregation saying, "You." And just talking specifically about the gift of prophecy. Okay, take healing, for example. You'll go and ask someone to pray for them when no one's watching. But will you do it when the whole congregation is watching? You have to develop. I understand. You cannot let fear stand in the way. And yes, you may need to do it. Okay, it's okay to pray in the hallway when no one's watching. But next time, the Lord might call you to pray in front of 100 people for someone's healing. He might call you to stand up and give a word in tongues. In front. Oh my goodness, the first time God ever gave me a word of interpretation, I was so petrified. But you know what? I was more afraid of not doing it because I knew it was from the Lord. And I had more fear of not doing it than I did of standing up in front of a large group of people and doing it. Because I knew it was something the Lord wanted everybody to know and to hear. Because I was part of the body. Someone else had given a word in tongues. And what was funny is, they said afterwards, "I never had anyone interpret my word before. She just, in a sense, she thought she was just praying her prayer language." Well, good, that's a whole other sermon. But it wasn't. And it was new for her, but she was willing to do it. She was willing to stand in front of a group of people and let the Holy Spirit speak through her. And then it took my willingness to bring forth what she had said. The body. Me reaching down for a drink. It took a great number of parts of my body to do that. Praise God. But the thing, this whole message today came about like this. I had someone give me a word this week. That I would not be saying this if I wasn't sure that it was coming from the Lord. Okay. But they had been given a vision of these hurricanes. And there are two more coming. At least, well, this particular vision, there are two more coming, and they will get worse. This one that we're still in the midst of right now, although it is down to a storm, devastated two parts of the United States. The ones that are coming will be worse. I was given that word, and so you can take that as a warning, and you can take it as a sign of the times we're in, okay? But the thing of it is, it came by way of a gift that had been given to someone. It was a vision. God gave them that gift. They're willing to use it. Now, they had asked that, you know, I'd be the one to bring that word or to go ahead and speak it, and that's fine. It's fine. But the point being, they didn't hold on to it. They didn't hide it. They were willing to, with confidence, come out with what the Lord has shown them. And that's what I want to encourage every one of you to do today. You were born with a gift. I'm telling you. You can say, oh no, not me. Well, you're human. If you were created by God and given birth by a human being, you were born with a gift/gifts from God. You can deny it until your dying day. But that doesn't make it a lie. It is absolute truth. You were born with gifts from God. And I say gifts because I'll be honest with you, I quite frankly believe that most people, if not all, were born with multiple gifts from the Lord. How we use them, is based on the decisions that you make. Obviously, God gab me a gift of gab. And I know I won't get any arguments from that one. I spent a vast majority of my life very shy. Not willing to talk. Not willing. I mean, I could be in the midst of like more than three family members. And I would clam up. I mean, family members, people I was around all the time. But if there were more than three or four, you wouldn't hear me talking. So when the Lord called me, I had to develop this gift to talk that He gave me. This He has called me into the office of a pastor, among others. Okay, I had to develop. I tell people, 23 and a half years ago, it'd be 24 years in February, that I gave my life to Christ. And, if I would have tried to stay, if I'd have got up that very day and walked up and tried to minister to people in front of a congregation in a church, if I'd have got up that day and tried to do that, you'd still be able to see the imprint or the tattoo across my forehead that said failure. Because I didn't even know I had that call at that point. And when I found it out, you know, the first time I preached, I talked about this not long ago. The first time I preached, I'll never forget it. I was in this nice fancy suit, dress shirt, tie, you know, I was decked out. And I was preaching in about, let's see, 15, probably about 25 or 30 feet from me was a swimming pool. It was outside, of course. I wasn't preaching in a swimming pool. But the point is, when I was there, when I walked up there, I'm telling you, I was petrified. And I had the notes. I mean, I had everything I wanted to say, I had it written down. You know, you look at my notes today, and it's just scripture. The rest the Holy Spirit does. But my point being, I looked like I had been in the swimming pool when I was done instead of the pulpit. I mean, literally, the sweat that came through the shirt, through the suit jacket, you know, I wouldn't surprise me if there's sweat dripping off the arms of the jacket. I knew I was soaked. But I did it. But now today, I sweat because of the Holy Spirit, because I'm just, you know, I'm just born to sweat. I sit around and go like this and sweat. But not like that. It's not a fear. It's confidence in the Holy Spirit. I had to develop that. And you have to develop the gifts that God put in you. But do that. Seek help. That's what leaders of the church are for, is to help you develop those gifts. You will not be right 100% of the time, I promise you. But that's okay. The one thing about failure is it means that success is on the way. But you can't let failure. The first time I tried to swing a ball bat, I didn't even know which end of the bat to grab. Later in life, and almost every team I played on, I was a leadoff hitter. Again, it was God-given ability, but my point being, I developed that. I took the time and effort to develop my swing. I took the time and effort to learn to keep my eyes on the ball. I took the time and effort to be a switch hitter. It wasn't overnight. And there's times I struck out. There was times I grounded out to the pitcher, especially when I was learning to bat left-handed. But I developed into a pretty good hitter. And that's what I'm asking you today to do. Develop, grow, nurture the gifts God put in you. We need you. The Lord says, I need you. We are in a time of great harvest. The harvest is great. The labors are few. I need you. The Lord is saying, I need you. I need you to develop and to use the gifts I placed inside of you. The growth of my kingdom depends on you and what I placed in you. I will never leave nor forsake you. Trust in me. Exhibit the love for me that you profess. Show me, says the Lord. I want to see it. Praise God. Once again, I will encourage you. You know, if you need help, if you need guidance, please seek it. We're here. I don't mind travel even. You know, if you want one-on-one, face-to-face, I'm good with that. But I can't, and you know, I can't meet you at McDonald's if you don't tell me you want me to meet you at McDonald's. We want to help you. Because it's critical in these times that we operate as the body of Christ. Again, I need a drink of water, but I can't do it without multiple parts of my body. And we can't operate at 100% without the fullness of the body. We need you. So make that commitment today. God bless you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we just thank you, Father, for this time and this word today, Father. We pray that we can be obedient to the call you've placed on us. We pray that we can recognize and use the gifts that you placed in us at birth, Father. They are gifts, Lord God. And we acknowledge that, and we pray that you help us to recognize and to develop and to use those gifts, Father. May you remove all fear, Father. You did not give us a spirit of fear. Help us defeat that fear, Father God, that we can be an integral working part of the body of Christ. And that it might operate in fullness, that your kingdom will increase. Father, use us. And we give you all the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, God bless you all. I do not respond to comments as much as I used to because using the cell phone creates a much higher quality video, but it does not afford me the ability to see all comments and what have you. I just wanted to get that out there. For those of you that don't know, the Coshocton County Fair is going on this week. And I say this, go minister to somebody. Take a walk. You know, walk up and down the Midway. Minister to someone. Just say, hey, you just start a conversation. Let the Lord lead you. Let the Holy Spirit lead you. And let's get out there and do our part as the body. All right, God bless you all. We love you. You cannot do anything about it. I will see you Tuesday with John chapter 21. And the Lord is leading me, since this will be the last chapter of John, he is leading me into the book of Proverbs will be our next place to go in Rock Through the Scriptures. Proverbs is broken up, and it's a train of thought can end in the middle of a proverb. So I'm not going to say I'm going to do chapter one day. I'm going to be led by the Spirit to go through the book of Proverbs and rock through the Scriptures after John chapter 21 this week. Again, God bless you all. Tamara will be live Thursday with word from the Lord. Until then, God bless you. We love you.